Hello and welcome everybody to this first in a series of webinars on cybersecurity. Today's topic is network-to-network protection and best practices for using VPNs for easy network-to-network protection. My name is Magnus Jansson and I am the Market Communications Manager at Westermo. Before I hand over the presentation to our experts, I would like to just give a brief Westermo company information as well as some housekeeping information. Westermo is a Swedish company who designs and manufactures data communication products for mission-critical systems in physically demanding environments. Our products are used both in social infrastructure, such as transport, water and energy supplies, as well as in process industries, such as mining and petrochemical. We have been in the business since 1975, and as a manufacturer of industrial data communication devices and software, we have gained a lot of knowledge within the company throughout the years. These webinars is a way for us to get some of that knowledge out there to you. We develop and manufacture all our products in our facilities in Sweden, and we have our own sales and support offices in 12 different countries across the world. We are also working with some 35 distribution partners around the world, as we know the importance of local presence for many of our customers. More information about the company and, of course, on our product portfolio can be found on the website. So if you want to know more, you can go to westermo.com and check that out. If you have any questions during the webinar, please use the chat window and post to host. I will gather questions at and if time allows, we will have a short question and answer session towards the end. If we see that we are running short on time, I will actually see to that we answer these questions in an email reply. So let's see how it goes. But if you have any questions, type them into the chat window and make sure it's addressed to host. Today's webinar is the first in a series of webinars, and we will be taking a closer look at the fundamentals of cybersecurity in industrial networks. And as I mentioned, the topic is regarding network-to-network protection and VPNs. And to present this topic, you will have Niklas Mört, who is Product Manager for Cybersecurity at Westermo, and Dr. Jon Olof Vatten, who is a very experienced network, a very experienced member of our network applications team. So I will hand over the presentation to Niklas and Jon Olof, and Niklas will make a bit of a presentation of himself and Jon Olof as well. So please, Niklas, the presentation is yours.
Oh, thank you, Magnus, and hello everyone, and welcome to this webinar regarding securing your network-to-network communication via VPN. As Magnus told you, my name is Niklas Mört, and I currently work at Westermo as Cybersecurity Product Manager. In short, that means that I oversee what we can offer today and what we should be able to offer in the future regarding cybersecurity. And as some of you might already know, Westermo is very well known for their very robust and resilient network equipment. And that, of course, also means that we have a lot of focus on cybersecurity. But since it's such a very broad topic, many times presentations or seminars regarding cybersecurity, they can have a tendency to become very broad and non-specific, and often focus more on the dangers out there and say the need for cybersecurity rather than actual solutions. But just by joining this webinar, I think you all have already shown that you are aware of the dangers and are thinking about security. So the purpose of this webinar is not to tell you that the threat is real. You already know that. It's not about telling you why you need security. You know that too. It's about telling you how to secure your network. As I mentioned in the beginning, we will be talking in this part about virtual private networks or VPNs. So to do that for the next 40 to 45 minutes, I have with me, as Magnus mentioned, my colleague, Dr. Jon Olav Vatn. He holds a doctor's degree in teleinformatics from the Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm. He has also been a very appreciated lecturer in internet working and internet security courses. In 2007, he fortunately joined the Westimo team, where he has played an integral part in the creation of our operating system that runs on all our managed devices, VOS. If you have ever used a managed Westimo device before and maybe consulted the management guide for help, the chance is that you have already been taught by Jon Olav. Apart from that, he is also an expert representative in the IEC Standardization Group for Communication on Train. And with that presentation, I would like to give a very warm welcome to Jon Olav Vatn.
Okay, thank you, Niklas, and welcome. Today's talk is about how to protect your site-to-site communication with VPNs. The outline is as follows. I will start with some introduction and make sure that we share the same terminology and some of the basic VPN concepts. After that, I will try to walk through step by step what you should consider when setting up a site-to-site VPN. Not only the VPN configuration itself, but also preparation steps, routing and NAT firewall, etc. And if we have time at the end, there will be some question and answers. Okay, what do we mean with VPN? And of course, acronym stands for Virtual Private Network. And in this context and today's talk, we will focus on secure real-time communication over an insecure network such as the internet. Real-time here is had live data. And we will talk about two types of VPNs, so site-to-site VPN, where you connect two or more sites, that is networks. In this picture, we have the branch office and the central office, and you would like to connect them and communicate between these sites in a secure way. We also have what is referred to as remote access VPN. And then you have individual units, hosts, it could be PCs, it could be your smartphone or any individual device which connect to a central office. So site-to-site, we also call network-to-network VPN. Remote access VPN is host-to-network VPN. We all know what a network is, but virtual and private then. Private in this sense is that we have confidentiality in the communication, and we achieve that by using encryption techniques. Anyone trying to listen in shouldn't really understand what's being said because it should be encrypted. And virtual, that is, it's not your own network. Instead, it's a shared infrastructure, and we build a kind of overlay network over a common infrastructure. So that is the context of today's talk. But there are other definitions of VPN or with slightly different meanings. You could also see it as an evolution of the old leased line concept, where you could go and contact your telecommunications operator that you would like to have your own network and rent some connections, ISDN or something else, to build your own private network. And if we extend that to the virtual private network, we have services where the telecommunications operator today can set this up over the internet, or the internet providers or telecommunication operators own internet infrastructure. And in this sense, private does not really need to mean that it's encrypted. It could be that it's your own network. So these services are really convenient and robust, so it's good to use. But when you sign up for such a service, just check if it means encrypted or not. Otherwise, you may have a surprise. Another common usage of VPN today is if you talk to your children, they will talk about circumventing geo-restrictions, geo-blocking. That could be different streaming services for sports events or perhaps movies, where there are different selections in different countries. So in order to actually access this material, maybe you need an IP address from a specific country. So common usage of VPNs is, in this case, to actually get access to another part of the world, get an IP address there, and from there you will access your service. Less amusing then is problems with censorship in some countries. You want access to the internet, but in order to do that, you in a safe way, maybe you need to open a VPN connection somewhere else in the world and then have free internet access. And these meanings of VPN, these are also VPN and using VPN technology, but that will not be the topic of today's talk. Okay. If we look at the picture here, we will have the chance to get some common terminology and entities. So we will use the term VPN gateway. Gateway means that you actually have some network behind that you would like to access or provide access to. And I will use Alice and Bob, Alice being in this case the VPN server and Bob being the client. And the client here is the party initiating the VPN connection, while Alice, the server, is the one waiting for someone, a client, to connect. So sometimes you can use the term initiator for client or responder for server. Commonly the term peers are used, and that just means that you have two peers who would like to connect. So that could be used instead of client or server to talk about the other end. In these pictures, we will use a central office network and a branch office network to demonstrate that you would like to have a secure communication between them. But in your applications, it's perhaps an industrial plant or some machines that you would like to access. So I hope you can map this these pictures to your situation. Occasionally, we use the term road warrior, and that could be a standalone PC or an individual host that accesses the internet and would like to connect to your home network, the central office, via VPN. So VPN, individual VPN clients are sometimes referred to as road warriors. The meaning here is that they could change IP address. So they could connect from home, they could connect from an internet cafe, from a hotel, from an airport, wherever they have network access. In this picture, we have also shown some firewalls. Doesn't really need to be there, but they can be there, and that gives extra challenges to connecting the VPN. But it's often good practice to have separate firewalls, but we can also have a firewall built into the VPN gateway itself. So that could be everything in one box. And occasionally you have both an external firewall and a firewall inside the VPN gateway. On the left side, we can also see that at the central office, the responder or server side, we have a backend authentication server. This is not at all necessary, but it can be convenient if you have a user database centralized. So if there connects many clients, instead of having all the configuration inside the VPN server gateway, when you should authenticate the connecting clients, you could relay the question or credentials to a backend authentication server and manage authentication there. That is, as I said, not necessary, but it's open convenient. So in the upper part, we demonstrate security between two networks, two sites, the central office and the branch office. And in the lower part, it's an individual host connecting to the central office. We call that a remote access VPN. In these pictures, we have just a single client in each. You have one server waiting for the client to connect. But we can extend the topology with multiple clients, as you see in the upper part here. You can have multiple branch offices connecting. You could also have multiple hosts connecting, and you can mix them in the same setup, of course. You could also create redundant site-to-site VPNs by having multiple gateways at each site. So you have two tunnels between the branch office and the central office. And the benefit here is primarily that you have redundancy. So if some internet connection goes down, traffic can flow to the other, and then you have a more reliable, a robust network. To handle the failover or change route of the traffic, we recommend using dynamic routing protocols like OSPF or RIP in this case. And OSPF and RIP also simplifies route distribution, because that is what routing protocols do. So some more theory. We will just explain phases of establishing a secure tunnel. This is beneficial later on when we discuss what you need to configure. Alice and Bob, the client and server, they should share some long-term secret. And there are two ways of doing this. You can use this based on symmetric encryption technologies, and then you have some kind of pre-shared key, some secret known both by Alice and Bob. It's called key AB in this case. But there is also asymmetric encryption using public key, private key cryptography, and certificates. It's not shown more in this picture, but we will come back to that later on in this presentation. So you have a long-term secret, and when Bob wants to establish the VPN tunnel, contacts Alice, he will present himself as Bob, and Alice somehow would like to make sure that it's really Bob who's connecting. So she sends some kind of challenge. She doesn't really ask him to send a common secret over the internet. Instead, she sends some kind of challenge and asks Bob to encrypt that message and send back. And she can check then that he must know their common secret. And vice versa, Bob would like to ensure that it's really Alice he is talking to. So part of the authentic key exchange phase is to prove identity. You should know who you're talking to. But there's another purpose as well, and that is to prepare the later data phase, what we really call when the VPN is up, when the tunnel is up. And as part of this key exchange, initially authenticated key exchange, we negotiate the cipher suite used later in the data transfer phase. And that in particular is what kind of encryption standard should we use, and what kind of integrity protection should we use. Very common is to have some flavor of AES 128, for example. for encryption, and some kind of SHA for integrity protection. For example, SHA-1, SHA-256. Another side effect of the authentication phase is to create the session key used for the data transfer phase. So we get this kind of key material, which you can use for the data transfer. We don't use the long-term secrets during the data transfer phase, because the more you use them, the easier, the more material an attacker has to try to crack your long-term secret. In the data transfer phase, almost always is used symmetric encryption techniques. We don't use asymmetric there, because that would be too take too much computation. Symmetric keys cryptography is a lot faster. Then, between Alice and Bob, they will send data encrypted, and that is somehow encapsulated. So the format of how to actually have the encrypted payload, how to do, how to add this authentication integrity checksum, is defined in the secure protocol. Okay, next, real-time security protocols that we use for VPNs. Real-time here means that we have some live data, as opposed to using secure email. That is also, of course, secure communication, but it will be just security for one message. Here you will have something live being used all the time. And we will focus here on the Vestemo VOS products, and they support two protocols. OpenVPN, we commonly call it the SSL VPN framework, and we also have IPsec VPN. Both of these protocols are, they provide roughly the same service. That means they have an authentication phase. You prove your identity, create keying material, as you showed on the previous slide, and then you have a tunnel where you can send your data. You can have site-to-site or remote access VPNs. What differs is a bit regarding the way it's implemented and the encapsulation. So with OpenVPN, we take the encrypted data and put inside a UDP or TCP packet. So we're calling that this is done on top of layer 4. But in IPsec, we have the IP header, and everything beyond the IP header is actually encrypted. So that is done really a layer at a somewhat lower layer in the OSI stack. And advantages of using IPsec, yes, it's a well-recognized ITF standard, and since it's done at the IP layer, it's usually done in your operating system kernel, providing relatively good performance. Some advantages of using OpenVPN, it has widespread platform support, and since it's done at a higher layer, it is better at dealing with firewalls or NAT. So that can be done with IPsec as well. But in particular, if you have if your VPN gateway is placed behind a third-party firewall, some other organization running that, that organization may not be willing to let IPsec traffic through, while OpenVPN usually gets through those firewalls. So there are pros and cons with both of them. For the rest of the presentation, we will focus on a more hands-on case, and then we will use OpenVPN. So in the remaining slides, we will go through what should you consider when you want to set up a site-to-site VPN. And setting up your VPN gateways, that involves a lot of steps. We will discuss the different steps. The details will not be shown here. We will provide an application note later on, so you can have a look more in just checking out and trying this yourself. And just relax and listen in to what we discuss here. So preparation steps will do. We will have the OpenVPN configuration, which is rather a minor part of all of this. You also need to ensure that routing works, so that traffic between the central office and branch office, that you find how to route. Alice and Bob often act as firewalls, and often you should configure NAT on them because they have a private network internally and then have an internet connection. And if you have an internet connection, the wide area network interface, you would like to harden it. So we will look briefly on what you should look at then. Okay, let's start with the preparation. So, of course, we need some hardware, Alice and Bob, the VPN gateways. So here we will focus on VOS units. So if you want to use Vestumo devices with VOS, make sure you have devices with software level extended. That means you should have, if you have a Redfox Industrial, it should be from the 200 series, or if you have a Lynx, it should be from the 200 series. Then you have support for VPN. You should, as always, install the latest firmware. But OpenVPN is not new. We have had it for a couple of releases, so the example here should work for older versions of VOS as well. You don't need to use VOS. We have other Vestumo units, the MRVs. In particular, if you want to use a wireless connection, you can use the MRVs. But you could use other devices as well, like PCs. You could use your smartphones or tablets. There is software to run OpenVPN there as well. Okay, so you have your devices. Then you should consider the IP plan. So this may sound a bit boring, but we need to make sure that what IP ranges you're using. In this example here, we have decided for our local networks to use addresses in range 10.0.0.0/16. It's a very large network used from the private IP address space. I use 10.0.0.0 just because it gives fewer number and easier to write. A bit special for OpenVPN is that the tunnel interface is part of a VPN subnet. So in this case, we have assigned network 10.0.0.0/24 for the VPN subnet. Alice and Bob will each of them have an IP address on the VPN subnet, and if you connect more clients, they will also connect to 10.0.0.0. Then for the central office network at Alice, we have 10.0.1.0/24, and the branch office at Bob has 10.0.2.0/24. And the plan here is that you could add more clients and networks. We can grow with Charlie and Dave as well at 10.0.3.0 and so on. So now we at least have some structure in our IP plan. We move on to the next step of the preparation. And if we are going to use OpenVPN, the long-term secret is to use certificates, and that is perhaps troublesome or seen as a hassle for by some users. We suggest that you download the easy RSA scripts from OpenVPN. There are other ways as well, and create your own certificate authority. And from a trust point of view, the VPNs you're going to set up is within your company. So running your own certificate authority is a good way of doing it, because who do you trust the most? That is, I guess, yourself. So please try this out. We also have a separate, and we'll send that as well afterwards, application note on how to use Easy RSA to create your certificates. But in essence, you will create your own certificate authority, a CA, and a certificate for that. And then you will create user certificates for Alice and Bob, signed by the common CA. There is a slight distinction in the ECRSA scripts for Alice and Bob, and that is Alice as a server should have some specific properties. So there should be a specific server script for creating those certificate or her certificate. The reason being that all of them, Alice, Bob, Charlie, and Dave, having certificates from the same authority, they will trust each other. But you would like to make sure that Bob is connecting to a server and not to some other unit presenting itself as a server. Okay, also at the same time, we haven't explained this, but with ECRSA, you can also generate TLS authentication key. So please generate that as well. We will discuss a bit what it's used for later on. Certificates, what they do is that they, when you have public key cryptography, Alice will present her public key, but you need a way to actually bind Alice identity, her name, and her public key together. And this is what's done in a certificate. And also they have a validity time. So the certificate is valid from a certain date to a certain date, and then signed by their common CA. So since this is includes time, we need to ensure that Alice and Bob also have correct time set on their units. So we suggest that Alice and Bob have NTP client enabled, so they could connect to an NTP server and get the correct time. That could be a server on the internet, since they have an internet connection, both of them. It could also be a local NTP server run by your organization. Then the last preparation step is when Bob wants to connect to Alice, he would like to use a domain name such as alice.example.com instead of an IP address. But Alice may not have a static IP address. Maybe she gets her IP address by DHCP dynamically from her ISP. So in order for domain names to work in this environment, Alice should sign up with a DDNS provider, dynamic DNS, such as Dyn DNS. We don't go through all the details here, but this is a mechanism so that if her IP address changes, she can automatically connect to the DDNS server, so that the domain name translation is updated accordingly. You could also consider having Bob using a DDNS service, but for the VPN purpose, it's usually Bob who would like to connect to Alice, not the other way around. But there may be other purposes why you would like to log in to Bob using a domain name, for example, for maintenance. So that could be a good idea as well. So now you have signed up for DDNS and configured that on your devices. Maybe you would like to have a backend authentication server at your server side. For example, Radius or Takax are supported by WeOS as backends. So this is not necessary. If you would like to try it out, you could, for example, download and install free Radius. By having a backend authentication server, when Bob would like to initiate the connection and provide his credentials, it's not always Alice that challenges. He could relay the communication to the common, to the backend authentication server, who will grant access to Bob. Okay, done with the preparation. If we have a look at the OpenVPN configuration in WeOS, you can start by selecting what mode you should run in, and that differs, of course, for Alice and Bob. Alice would run a server, which is the default, but Bob would be configured as a client. And if you are a client, you should set your peer, who should you connect to. So somewhere you should fill out the domain name or IP address if you know that, but the domain name of the server here, alice.example.com. If you look at further down on this picture, there is security settings. Here you should upload your created certificates, your private key, and the CIA certificate as well, and use those. And there is an optional identity password if you have decided to use that. Otherwise, it's just the certificates themselves that handles the authentication. So for the data transfer phase, we should have cipher suites. And in this case, it's not really a negotiation. Both client and server need to configure exactly which ciphers to use for OpenVPN. So we suggest you, for encryption, use AES 128. Default is today somewhat lower, so please change this. We will fix that as well in later releases. For integrity protection, use SHA-1 or better. And SHA-1 is default. Continuing with the OpenVPN configuration, if we look at the virtual subnet, said we have a virtual subnet for the tunnel that's created will have in each end a tunnel interface. We call them SSL interface, since OpenVPN uses SSL and TLS mechanisms. For OpenVPN, you could decide if your tunnel interface should be operating at layer 2, sending MAC frames in the tunnel, or at layer 3, sending IP frames. And in this case, when we have a site-to-site VPN, we must use layer 2, otherwise the routing will not work. If you would have remote access VPNs with a lot of hosts connecting, you could use either layer 2 or layer 3, and default is layer 3 then. But for site-to-site, we must set up the interface as being a layer 2. Then we have decided what subnet to use. On the server side, we have a static address, and we have chosen to use the lowest address, 10.0.0.1, for Alice. At the client side, it's very common to have dynamic, but in our case here, we will actually use static. But in other cases where you have dynamic, Alice would assign an address to Bob as part of the tunnel establishment. And she could do that by using a pool, or she could assign a specific address like 10.0.0.2 with a special mechanism called CN binding. That means when Bob establishes the tunnel, she looks at the name in the certificate, the common name, and matches that to a specific address. In this example later on, we will use either a static address or we'll use a pool for assigning addresses to Bob. Okay. The last part of the OpenVPN configuration, that is TLS authentication, and I mentioned that earlier. This is not needed, but it's really good practice. Alice, as a responder, she will wait for clients to connect. That means she has an open port to the internet, to the WAN interface, where clients could connect, but you could also have attackers trying to launch port scans or distributed denial of service attacks. So we would really like Alice to be as silent as possible or resistant as possible to these kind of attacks. And one way to do this with OpenVPN is to add an additional key used in the authentication phase. With this key, the messages in the authentication phase utilize an additional key shared by Bob and Alice and possibly Charlie, Dave, and all others that are part of this VPN. And the idea is that when Bob tries to establish the tunnel, if he doesn't use the right key here, Alice will not even respond, and she will not build up any state either. So she will be resistant to port scans, but she will also be resistant to dynamic denial of service attacks, which just sends a lot of initiation messages trying to take the server down because it saves a lot of state. So please use TLS authentication by the server or to protect the server. Okay, that was the OpenVPN configuration steps. There are some other settings as well, but default values will work fine there in almost all cases, and in particular in the cases we are discussing here. Now, we have the tunnel up, but traffic from Alice's network to Bob's network will not really be routed through the tunnel unless we tell it to do so. So, in this case, we'll look at static routing, meaning that, as opposed to dynamic routing, which will come next. The simplest form in this case would be on the virtual subnet to use static addresses for Alice and Bob. So we assign 10.0.0.1 to Alice and 10.0.0.2 to Bob. And then Alice should set a static route to the other side, meaning you'd add a route to Bob's network 10.0.2.0 with next hop 10.0.0.2, which is then Bob. And vice versa at Bob's side, he will add a route to 10.0.1.0, that is Alice network, via 10.0.0.1. So there are other ways which will be explained in the application note, but this is probably the simplest form of doing this. Now traffic can start to flow through the tunnel to the other side and then be encrypted, of course. An alternative method is, instead of using static routing, we can, as before, Alice could have a static address. Bob, for simplicity, he could get his tunnel interface address dynamically. That means Alice could use a pool to hand out addresses. Just like with DHCP, OpenVPN provides a way to assign addresses during tunnel establishment. And then if we configure a dynamic routing protocol such as OSPF or RIP, Alice and Bob will start to talk to each other through the tunnel if we enable that in RIP. And here it doesn't matter if Bob has a dynamic address, because they will detect each other by the routing protocol and exchange route information as RIP and OSPF always do. So that will automatically populate the routing tables. Benefit of this method is that it also facilitates a redundant VPN topology. If you have multiple routers, multiple tunnels at both sites, OSPF or RIP will make sure that traffic finds the way. If one tunnel goes down, it will make sure that you route traffic the other way. This is not really possible with static routing, then you have to go in and do this manually. Okay, now you have seen two alternatives doing routing. Alice and Bob commonly provide internet access for their local networks. So even if we are discussing connectivity between the central office and branch office, the users would also like to access the internet. Commonly there is that you have private networks here, and then you have using IP mask grading or NAPT to access the internet via the public address of Addis Wide Area Network Interface. So if you enable NAPT, you will also enable the firewall in WIOS. So this will be at the same time a simple firewall, but it's very, very robust. So it will block all traffic by default unless you tell it to allow it through. So traffic from the internet will not access inside unless you have rules for that. Also, when you enable the firewall, you must tell the firewall to allow traffic to flow between the local networks and through the tunnel. So that is done as part of the firewall configuration to add allow rules between the local interface here, known as VLAN 1, and the tunnel interface called SSL 0, and vice versa. Also, one more thing to consider is that if the tunnel is down, Alice and Bob does not really have the route to, doesn't really know where to send traffic to the VPN because the routes are not up. And then there is a risk that traffic will go to the default interface, meaning that it will be sent out unencrypted on the internet. So as an additional routing rule, you should connect a black hole route, meaning that if it doesn't find a better route, it should send it to a black hole interface. This makes sure that you don't, by mistake, send data unencrypted to the internet just because the VPN is down. And then finally, now we have the VPN up and running. Alice and Bob being gateways on the internet. We should also have an extra look at the wide area network interface. In this case, it's VLAN 2, which is the public interface or wide area network interface. We would like to limit exposure. We have firewall functionality, but we also have some services enabled, and we should consider that. One way is to add an external firewall. But anyway, it's a good habit to do some hardening on the wide area network interface. For instance, we say that we would like to disable all remote management services on the wide area network interface. So disabling web, SSH, and HTTPS and all of that. SNMP, so that is not available on the from the outside. Also, Alice and Bob, as part of being routers, they are commonly DHCP servers, and shown that here, but then they are also perhaps DNS proxies. So adding additional firewall rules so that DNS is not available, if that port is not open from the outside, is also a good habit. You can disable other services like LLDP on this interface, so you don't, this is perhaps not that important, but just being as silent as possible on the wider network interface is a good habit. And then there are other good practices. Of course, you should have a secure admin password on your units, and disable unused services. For example, if you don't use ipconfig, please disable it. Have one remaining question here is, maybe you would like to have some remote management available on your wider network interface. For instance, you could enable SSH or HTTPS for remote management purposes. This could be good, for example, if you cannot access Bob, the tunnel is down, so you cannot access it that way. Maybe you would like to do some maintenance and see what's wrong. But if you haven't enabled any service on its wider network interface, you more or less you have to go there and log in from the local ports instead. So depending on your security policies and your wishes, maybe you would like to open up for management from the VAN interface as well. Okay, now I think I've covered the most important points of setting up site-to-site VPN gateways. For your knowledge, we are done with this, and there will be application notes being sent out later on, which I urge you to try out. But we also at Vestermo have a WeConnect service. That means we have a VPN service with a more VPN in the cloud, which could be of interest. So if you're interested in that, please have a look at our website for more information. Now, this was okay. Maybe it's time just to hand over to Magnus, because this was all I had to present. Thanks for listening in.
All right.
Thank you so much for that. We have some questions coming in, but we are running short of time, so I believe that we will answer those in email instead. Before we conclude the meeting, I just want to give you a last information here. First of all, this is the first webinar in a series of webinars where we will discuss the fundamentals of industrial cybersecurity as well as how to use Vestermo networking products and our operating system VOS to help you to achieve a sustainable security posture.
Next session
will be about network segmentation and how to divide your network into different zones to strengthen your security defense. This is something that should be part of every company's industrial security strategy as a properly segmented network will reduce the attack surface, limiting an attacker's potential to move laterally in the network, strongly limiting
the potential damage of a cyber attack. We will run this webinar 20th of February in next year, and I hope you like to join this session as well. When I actually end this session, you will be automatically transferred to the sign up page for the next session. So if this seems to be interesting to you, you can just sign up there right away. And finally, I just want to inform you that you will receive an email including a playback recording link if you wish to repeat anything from today's session. There will also be a link to the registration form for the next webinar. And just as Jon Olof mentioned, you will also have a link to download the application note where you can try this out as well. And of course, I will also add some contact details to your local Westmo office or distribution partner if you'd like to ask for a tender, or if you have any question regarding our product portfolio. And with that, I wish to thank you for joining in, and I hope that you found this webinar useful. Good luck to you in your cybersecurity work. Do not hesitate to contact us if you need to. We are here to help if you need it. So thank you for listening, and goodbye.